I come to the garden alone. While the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the song
people that want to serve God and that He's gifted them as He has. I'm going to take 1 minute or two, any testimonies. I'm not going to prod for them. Anybody have anything they'd like to say tonight? Have at it. Bill. So you go all the way back to Brother Irvine.
Yeah, I did preach here for him.
Huh?
I preached for Brother Irvine.
Yeah. Yeah, so you knew Brother Irvine. That goes back a ways.
And Brother Boatwright?
Boatwright. I don't go back that far.
Don't go back that far? I go back way far.
Anyway.
Amen.
Great to have you on board.
Thank you. Amen. I'm glad to be here tonight. I have so many memories. I was sitting there thinking, you know, of all these memories I have, and I can't go through all of them because it just takes too long. You know, tell me, I have till 8:30, right? Well, I have till 8:30, but you guys believe in it's 7, right?
You heard everybody laugh when you said that.
It was kind of a nervous laugh, too.
Kind of, well, not really.
Yeah. Well, I'm so good to see Brother Lyle Smith and his precious wife. Good to see Rod. I first met Brother Smith. Jack Garner is supposed to be holding a revival meeting in Long Beach, and I was his advance man back then, back in the 70s, and he couldn't, for some reason, I can't remember the reason, he couldn't make that meeting, so they asked me to go ahead and preach the meeting for him, and during that meeting, the Smith family came and sang, with Carla and Brother Smith. I can't remember, it was Rod and Stan, or just one of them?
Carla, Darla.
Yeah, and we just had a great time. Matter of fact, during that revival meeting, my sister-in-law walked the aisle and got saved.
Amen.
And I just talked to her a few years ago after my mother passed away, and after my brother passed away, and she still remembered walking the aisle and receiving Amen. Christ as Savior. I had the privilege yesterday. I knew a lady over 50 years ago. I got saved here in this town, as most of you know, back in 1961, and as a 9-year-old boy. And there's a girl in our, a couple years older than me in the youth group as we were growing up. And she was a saved girl and so forth. But I hadn't seen her for over 50 years. But she's a good friend of my sister. Well, my sister found out I was out here and contacted her. And her daughter, the girl's name, you might know her, Jan, was Sue Morgan. And but her daughter has come down with cancer. She's only 48 years old. They asked if I'd go over and see her, and so God always gives you opportunities if you're willing to go. And so I went over and talked to her for nearly 2 hours, and at the end of our conversation, she got on her knees and received Christ as her Savior.
Amen.
And that's what it's all about, getting people saved and changing lives. God had called me to be an evangelist. That's what my plan was. That's what I believed I was going to do. And as I was working for Jack Garner, the evangelist, the man that used to be the executive vice president of Pacific Coast before Jack Baskin, Dean Goddard, was pastoring at Mid-Cities Baptist Temple over in Downey, and he got a hold of me and he said, I want you to be my youth director. I said, I don't want to be a youth director. I did that for my father-in-law, but I built a good group of over 70 teens there, and he said, I want you to be my youth director, and I said, I don't want to be the youth director. And he said, look, you owe me. We're sitting at the old Sambo's restaurant. Remember those Sambo's restaurant on Paramount and Imperial? And he said, you owe me. You know, what can you say to the guy? And so I said, okay, I'll give you 1 year. He said, okay, good enough. I'll give you 1 year. He said, you have to teach in our Christian school and do the youth group and so forth. And some of those teenagers still I have contact with today. I was there for 2 weeks, and the man resigned. The pastor resigned and went to Casper, Wyoming. And the deacons approached me and asked me if I wanted to be the pastor. I says, no, I don't want a pastor. And I changed my mind since then, by the way. I said, I didn't want a pastor. And make a long story short, they connived me. You know, deacons can do that. And they connived me. They said, well, just come over to our house, have dinner with us, preach Sunday morning, Sunday night, have a question and answer period. Let the church vote and then make your decision. You know, I was a kid. I was 25. And I said, okay. And we did that, and they took a vote, and they voted unanimous to call me. So what am I going to do? Well, I say all that to say this. I've known Jan C. DeBacchus since she was in the third grade. And I think I was there about a year when I asked her to come over and be the secretary over there. It was about a year, Jan. Speak up, Jan. Anyway, she came over and worked as the secretary and close friends with my wife. And then we had the Christian school, and we'd moved it over to Hoxie here in Norwalk, and we had to build the school and make it larger to bring enough money in and so forth. So I talked to my deacons about putting up this big campaign of advertising to get more students. I said, all we have to do is get 3 students in order to pay for this advertising. They reluctantly agreed, let me do it. We did it. Got 197 students out of that advertising. One of those who came was Steve Sitabaka. He brought little Tricia, and she was, I think, four at the time, wasn't she? She was four at the time, put her in our K-4 program, and Steve was around for just a little while, and he got saved. And we're so glad he did, and we counseled them about marriage and stuff, and look what God's done. They take off on Sundays to go to on cruises and stuff like that. But they've been good friends of mine for lots and lots of years now. And thank God, just thank God for them and the great memories. And thank God for your pastor and his wife and the faithfulness that they've shown through the years. And you've always been a friend to me and my family, and we love you guys dearly. And I don't want to say too many more names because I'll forget somebody, but I love the Smith family. Love half of the Mitchell family. And no, I can't just, I'm sorry, I can't help myself. Please take your Bible, if you would, and turn to the book of Mark, the 6th chapter. And while you're turning there, I just have a quick story to tell you. You know, I don't know if you ever heard the story before, but you know, you who are pastors or you've been a pastor before, you know, sometimes preachers have what they call the Monday morning blues. You know, you can't stay up here all the time. Anybody try to stay up here all the time, you're going to have problems. You've got to have your ups and downs. You've got to be able to level things out. But a lot of preachers take Mondays off because of the fact that they got to recharge their batteries, and they have to, you know, just rest because their mind is weary, let alone their body. And so I heard about this preacher that he had the Monday morning blues, and he got up, he's really feeling bad. His wife was gone, his kids were gone, he's really feeling bad. And so he went in the bathroom and shaved. He even looked in the mirror and thought he looked ugly, and he's probably right about that. And then he went into the kitchen, and he thought, well, if I get a cup of coffee, but that's going to help me. So he went in to make a cup of coffee, and he's out of coffee. All he had was instant Sanka. How many ever drank that instant Sanka? Doesn't it taste like cardboard? It tastes awful, but that's all he had. So he made himself some instant Sanka. He went to the cupboard to get some bread. His wife had forgotten to go shopping, and all they had was raisin bread, and he hated raisin bread. So here's this preacher, Monday morning, picking the raisins out of that bread and talking under his breath to that bread. And then he pops it up out of the toaster and he butters it real good. And next thing he knows, he's got butter running down his hand through the holes from those raisins. But he eats that raisin bread or that toast, and he drinks that Sanka coffee. And when he got done, he was feeling great. He couldn't understand what happened here. I've got to write this down and find out the reason why I feel so good all of a sudden, because this would be a formula for every Monday. So he got out a piece of paper and he began to write things down. All the things he had done that morning, all of a sudden it hit him. He had been shaved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Toast. And that's what did it. That's what did it. I talked to a couple of men in our church back in Independence, Kansas this morning, and they just suffered an ice storm. And the town next to ours found 4 inches worth of ice on the trees. 4 inches, that's a lot. And I said, if you don't go to church, you're backslidden, as I'm out here in sunny California. I'm just kidding. And so we were talking about it, and I got to thinking, I heard a story about this preacher years and years ago in the cowboy days. And he's in an old cowboy town, and a big storm had come through, and the snow had piled up, and nobody was going through that little town. But he, as a faithful preacher, went down to the church building, and he got all the snow away from the door, and he got the door open, and he went inside, and he got that potbelly stove going to warm it up a little bit. And then he sat up on the platform, knowing no one's going to show up. Well, about 5 minutes till 11, the back door opens up. This cowboy comes walking in with his big cowboy boots and takes his big hat off, and he's dusting the snow off his hat and brushing the snow off his shoulders. Preacher didn't know who it was, and he just walked down and sat right down in the front row. Preacher stands up and says, well, you're the only one here. You want me to preach or not? cowboy said, well, I don't know much about preaching, but I do know about cattle. And if I only had one cattle come in, if I only had one cow that would come in, he said, I sure would feed him. Preacher said, okay. So he went at it. He preached for an hour, preached for 2 hours, went for 3 hours, sweating up a storm, just 3 hours long. He got done and he said, okay, cowboy, what do you think about that? Cowboy said, well, I don't know much about preaching, but I know about cattle. And I know this, if I only had one cow come in, I wouldn't feed him the whole load. So I won't feed you the whole load tonight, but in the book of Mark, chapter number 6, please. Mark chapter number 6. Let's look over, please, to verse number 35. Chapter 6, verse number 35. And when the day was far spent, his disciples came unto him and said, this is a desert place, and now the time is far past. Send them away, that they may go into the country round about and into the villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. He answered and said unto them, give ye them to eat. And they say unto him, shall we go and buy 200 pennyworth of bread and give them to eat? He saith unto them, how many loaves have ye? Go and see. And when they knew, they say, 5 and 2 fishes. And he commanded them to make all sit down by companies upon the green grass. And they sat down in ranks by hundreds and by fifties. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, he looked up to heaven and blessed and brake the loaves and gave them to his disciples to set before them. And the 2 fishes divided he among them all. And they did all eat and were filled. And they took up 12 basketfuls of fragments and of the fishes. And they did eat of the loaves, were about 5,000 men. Now keep that story in mind as you turn over to chapter 14 of the same book. Mark chapter 14. In the 14th chapter, we'll read the first 9 verses. It says, after 2 days was the feast of the Passover and of unleavened bread. And the chief priests and the scribes sought how they might take him by craft and put him to death. But they said, not on the feast day, lest there be an uproar among the people. And being in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at meat, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very precious, and she brake the box and poured it upon his head. And there were some that had indignation within themselves and said, why was this waste of the ointment made? For it might have been sold for more than 300 pence and have been given to the poor. And they murmured against her. And Jesus said, let her alone. Why trouble ye her? She hath wrought a good work on me. For ye have the poor with you always, and whensoever ye will, ye may do good to them. But me ye have not always. She hath done what she could. She is come aforehand to anoint my body to the burying. Verily I say unto you, wheresoever this gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her. Now, in these 2 stories, you see repeated that there is something very special that happens. In the story in Mark chapter 6, they needed the fish and the bread to feed 5,000 men alone. And we always talk about the great miracle, the feeding of the 5,000, and it was a great miracle. But because we so many times concentrate on that miracle, we miss some hidden truth that is transforming to the Christian life. And one of the transforming truths here is that it says, the Bible says that he blessed it, he broke it, and then he dispersed it, you see. He blessed it and he broke it. Remember that. Then in the 14th chapter, is the lady who came and had that box of spikenard, that very precious ointment, and she broke it. And by the way, what that was worth was, in that day, a year's salary. A year's salary, that's what it was worth. I mean, like taking your paycheck for a year and spending it upon the Lord. And she broke that and anointed him for the burying. It had to be broken in order to be used. The fish had to be broken in order to be used. The bread had to be broken in order to be used. Now, with that in mind, please look with me to John chapter 4. John chapter number 4. I want to give a truth tonight that I think is transforming. I think it's a truth that will change our perspective on trials in our life and seemingly hard times in our life. As we look at John chapter 4, if you look down, please, to verse number 16, where it says, Jesus saith unto her, Go, call thy husband, and come hither. Talk about that woman, you know, who had five husbands and at Jacob's well. Verse 17, The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, Thou hast well said, I have no husband. For thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou hast is not thy husband. In that saidst thou truly. He said, you've had five husbands, and the man you're living with now is not your husband. And look what she says in verse 19. The woman said unto him, Sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye said that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye shall worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. And here's the key, verse 24. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Okay, so here we have these three stories. The first story is about the bread and the fish, that they had to be blessed, they had to be broken in order to be used. The ointment of spikenard, the box had to be broken in order for the spikenard to be used in the service of the Lord. And then Jesus, speaking to this woman who had five husbands and was living with a man who wasn't her husband, he said to her that God is a spirit. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Where's the problem here? The problem is that spirit, as a Christian, as a born-again Christian, the spirit lives within our spirit. And in order to have this, our spirit be able to be used for God and for his service, there must come a breaking of the flesh. There must come a breaking of our flesh to a place of complete surrender unto him. This is of utmost importance for the Christian. So many Christians live their life saying, why am I going through physical torment? Why am I going through financial trouble? And we know sometimes we bring some of those problems on ourselves. But I'm talking about those Christians who are really trying to live for God. And they really, they believe with all their heart, they're surrendered. They want to be what God wants them to be. And they read their Bibles and they pray and they witness and they try to live a godly, holy life. We know nobody lives it perfectly, but in their heart, they're trying. And they say, why am I going through all these trials? I'll tell you why. God has to get past our flesh. God has to get past our flesh. And so, my friend, he must break our flesh to get to our spirit. He must bring us to a place of brokenness. Well, I thought I was already broken. Oh, there's different degrees of brokenness, my friend. God needs to get past our flesh and past the things in our life that hinder us, And we can say, you know, I've surrendered myself, and that may be true. But let's look at a couple of quick examples. Let's look at the story in 2 Corinthians chapter number 12. The older I get, the more profound I see the truths of God's Word. They're profound, life-changing truths in His Word. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, I want us to look at the breaking of the Apostle Paul. Chapter 12, verse 7. Paul said, "And lest I should be exalted above measure." In other words, to keep me from getting to a place where I think that I'm something, or getting full of myself, through the measure of the abundance of revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought, I prayed, I begged the Lord. Three times I asked Him that it might depart from me. And He said to me, "My grace is sufficient. My grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in weakness." Most gladly, Paul says, "Therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong." Listen, Paul, I believe one of the greatest, if not the greatest Christian who ever lived in the New Testament age. This man, the Apostle Paul, all he went through, shipwrecks, beaten and left for dead, sent to prison unjustly over and over again. This man, and God gave him revelations, and he started churches all over that area, and God was greatly using him. He said, "But God said to me," and I believe he had an eye problem, because he said the messenger of Satan to buffet me, and you study that out, it's actually saying that he was beaten about the eyes till black and blue. I believe he had an eye problem, had a hard time seeing. Some say he was also hunchback. And he had a lot of hurting going on in his body. And he said, "God, because He gave me so many revelations, and I can very easily become pumped up and think I'm more than I really am. And God gave that to me to keep me leveled out, to keep me leveled out." And the amazing thing, Paul says, I've learned in all these things, I take pleasure in my infirmities. I take pleasure in reproaches. I take pleasure in necessities and persecutions and distresses, because I've learned something. He said, "For when I am weak, then am I strong." What he was saying is, when I realize I can't do it, I can't make it, God, I need You. When I come to that place of emptying myself and saying, I just can't do this, I can't live this way, then God says, "Okay, now I'll step in. Now I'll step in." He said, "I've learned that when I am weak, He's strong, you see, and He can help me through all these different difficulties I go through." Paul was living the godly life, living a righteous life, and he went through more than any of us in this room will ever go through. We have to understand that. Now, I learned a verse when I was 11 years old. I had a Sunday school teacher who had me memorize this verse, and it became my life verse. And some of you recognize this. "Trust the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. And lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy path." When the Apostle Paul was being broken, when the Apostle Paul had the hammer of God coming down upon him, he learned that he could trust God no matter what the outward circumstances were. Whether it was physical, financial, emotional, family, whatever the problem was, he knew he could make it, because when he was weak, he was strong. He realized that God had the power to do it. Now, looking at some believers through history, we could look at contemporary believers. We could look at believers over the last 2,000 years, but let's go back to the Old Testament. Noah. Just remember, Noah had surrendered to God. Noah had taught his family about the coming of the flood. He had taught them about the second coming of Christ. It was a godly family, Noah's family. And after they had surrendered, and after they built that huge ark, and after people laughed at them, and the public laughed at them for building a big boat out in the middle of the desert, after all that surrender, after all that preaching and nobody getting saved, after all the surrender of Noah and his family, then the storm came. Then the storm came. When they were absolutely surrendered to God, and they were doing everything that God told them to do, they're being obedient to God, and then the storm came. You see, many Christians today can't understand, if they're trying to serve God, why is a storm here? Because God loves you, and He's trying to break the ointment box. He's trying to tear apart those fishes. He's trying to pull apart those loaves of bread. He wants to break them. He wants to bless them. He wants to use them. And friend, we cannot be broken and blessed and used until we're willing to be broken and allow God to break us, you see. Abraham left his country, going into a far country, not knowing where he is going. Didn't know where he's going. He just knew God told him to go, so he pulled up roots, took his whole family with him, and he took off on the journey. And after years of obeying God, now he wasn't perfect, we know he wasn't perfect, he made some mistakes with Ishmael and so forth, but after all these years of him living that surrendered life, and finally God gave him the son Isaac. After all those years of surrender, God one day led him outside the city and told him to go up on top of this mountain and build an altar there and to tie his son to that altar and then sacrifice that son that God had promised him years and years before. He went up there, as you know, and he took that knife and he's ready to plunge it into his son, and then God stopped him and said, "Now I know you'll not withhold anything from me." Folks, I don't understand all that. I don't understand it, but what I do understand is this, that this trial came into the life of Abraham after years of surrender. After years of surrender, God had to break him again, because there are different levels of breaking. God breaks us for every new area of life He's taken us into. Every new chapter in our life that we're going into, God allows that breaking to take place. Then think about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's in the book of Hebrews, it says that He learned obedience by the things that He suffered. And we're talking about He being 100% God, 100% man, but it says He learned obedience by the things He suffered. Now, if Christ had to learn obedience through the things He suffered, why should I have to be any different than that? Why should we not expect for God to allow trials in our life? But we say, "Pastor, Brother Munson, I don't like trials." Who does? Nobody likes trials. But I tell you what, the end result, when you come out the other side, on the victory side, it's all worth it. It's all worth it. Every bit of it is worth it. Christ suffered because of His surrender. The truth that we need to look at, folks, is this. Anything God uses, He breaks. Anything God uses, He breaks. And your breaking is different than mine. And mine is different than yours. What God takes each one of us through is unique to ourselves. Now, we didn't know Paul, the Apostle Paul, personally. I can't wait to see him, although I'm not signing up for the next load. We didn't know him personally. But yet, God knew him. And God knew what He needed to take Paul through to get him to the place He wanted him to be. And it's an amazing story. But your story is just as amazing, because God loves you every bit as much as He loves Paul. Your story is unique, and God has a path that He's taken you down. And there may be many breakings along the way as He leads you into ministry and leads you in your Christian life, just like He did the Apostle Paul. Your breaking is unique to you. Husbands need to pray for their wives. Wives need to pray for their husbands. Parents ought to pray for their kids, and kids for their parents, and brothers for sisters, and sisters for brothers, because we don't know what they're going through in their hearts. But we do know that we have a God in heaven that loves all of us and has a unique path for each one of us to take. And our breaking is going to be unique to us. Now here's what happens. Some Christians balk at it and get bitter and get angry and say, God, why me? Why me? Why am I going through this? Instead of saying, God, what do you have for me? God, what are you teaching me? God, where are you bringing me to? Help me to learn the lessons I need to learn in order to get where I need to get. I've lived long enough now to look back and see the miraculous things that God has done. And I could stay here, I promise you, all night long and tell you story after story after story after story of what God has done through the years to bring me to where He wanted me to be. As most of you know, about 9 months ago, my wife went to heaven. And I preached her funeral, and people got saved at the funeral. People came from 10 different states to come to honor her, and Jan and Steve were there. And one man asked me how you could preach your wife's funeral. I said, listen, who loved her better than I did? And she'd expect me to. She'd expect me to preach her funeral. Some of my kids have struggled with it off and on. And they'll say, Dad, why, we cry a lot. Why don't you cry? I say, well, first of all, when I'm alone, I have my times. We were married 43 years. Knew her since she was 7 and I was 9 years old. And always grew up together. But I told the kids, here's what you have to look at. And by the way, this is a different breaking for me. It's okay. It's okay. God's working in my life today at 64 just like He always has. I tell my kids, what you've got to do is you cannot look at the years you're not going to have. You look at the years that God gave you and the blessings that He gave you and the lessons of life. And we are all starting a new chapter in our life, and God's getting ready to do something magnificent, because He wouldn't take us through the valley if He wasn't. He wouldn't put a new breaking in there if He wasn't about to do something very special. You see, God has to break us in order to use us the way He wants to. This evening, I want you to think in your own heart, because I guarantee you, and all these pastors can back me up, that everybody in this room is going through something. Everybody in this room is going through something. Whether physical, financial, emotional, spiritual, you're going through a difficulty. Have you ever thought that God is allowing this? Not because you're doing anything wrong necessarily, but God's allowing it because anything that He uses, He has to break first. Like the Apostle Paul says, when I am weak, then am I strong. Have you ever thought that God has something great in the next chapter of your life, and God is preparing you right now for something great tomorrow? When I was 17 years old, my dad passed away. We'd been praying for him for years. And we lived out in Lakewood. And 3 months before he passed away, he came to Christ and got saved. He was transformed in 3 months. He really was. He wanted me to read the Bible to him all the time. And he was dying of cancer. But when he died, my mom had to move back to Iowa because she couldn't afford to live in California on her own. So she packed up us 4 boys and we moved back to Iowa. Got into a little town there, 1,800 people. A lot of little towns like that in the Midwest. 1,800 people. There are 7 churches in town, and the only one church that preached the gospel was the Evangelical Free, but they weren't really strong on salvation and baptism and stuff like that. And so one day I told my little brother Bart, he was 10, I told him, I said, we're going to start our own church. He said, what? I said, yeah. I said, we're going to start our own church, And I'm going to be the pastor, and you're going to be my song leader. I was 17, he was 10. And he said, really? So I got some tracts, wrote our address on it, and him and his friends went all around town passing these tracts out. We had a shed out in the back of our house, about 20 feet long, maybe 10 feet wide, and we got in there and cleared that thing out, took the hornet's nests out of that thing. Thing was hot in there, and we scrubbed the floors. We made our own benches out of wood, made a pulpit. It wasn't like this. It was like just about that tall with a flat piece of wood on it. And then we didn't have a piano player, couldn't fit a piano in there anyway. And so we went in the house and got a record player. The young kids don't know what that is. A record player. And all the music I had was, I had albums of the Blackwood Brothers, the old Blackwood Brothers Quartet. So we'd put on there one of the familiar songs, you know, that most people should know. And my brother Barton up there, he didn't know how to sing. He'd just go like this. Just like this, you know. And him and I would be the only ones singing because no one knew the songs. The first Sunday, we had 26 people in that shed. 26, including three adults. And he said it led singing. And it was so hot in that place. And I preached. And people got saved. We had a vacation Bible school. And out in the yard by our house. And that went on for months. And kids around town are saying, hey, are you the guy that started that church in the shed? I said, yeah. Well, I graduated from high school, went off to Bible college, got married, became a pastor, and 1986, here we are talking about 17 years later, Janet and I and our three kids at the time went back to Iowa on vacation. Well, where my mother lived, I knew there was no gospel church there, so we decided to find a church, the closest one, went to Berean Baptist Church in Boone, Iowa, and went into church that day. It was a regular Baptist church. And I didn't tell the pastor I was a pastor, nothing like that, but he introduced all the visitors. He had us stand, and I introduced my wife and my kids. Didn't tell them I was a pastor, nothing like that. And after the service is over, this man walks down the aisle. I'm sitting on this side over here, and he walks down the aisle. He looks at me, and he shakes my hand. He goes, you don't remember me, do you? I said, I'm sorry, I don't. He said, my name's Sam Smiley. I'm a deacon here. It's my wife playing the piano over here. He said, I want you to know, I got saved in the church in the shed. I got saved in the church in the shed because I told everybody in my life, I got saved in the shed. And he did. You know, the only reason I tell that story is this, folks. When I went through a breaking period, and that was a breaking period for me, I sat out in my backyard and wept before God and said, why did I have to leave Norwalk where my church was and the girl I was in love with? Why did I have to leave and come back to this God-forsaken place and all that? You see, I went into my bedroom one day and I said, God, I'm not coming out of here till you do something. And I spent 8 days in that bedroom without coming out and just reading the Bible and praying. And all of a sudden one day it's like the glory of God came down on me. That's when I started the church in the shed. See, I couldn't understand at 17 years old why I was going through something like that until 1986 when Sam Smiley says, hi, my name's Sam Smiley. I got saved in the church in the shed. If God wouldn't have broken me at that time, maybe Sam would never got saved. You see, your breaking that God is putting in your life, it's not about you. It's not about me. It's about Him and salvation and His glory and His honor. We are to be servants in His hands and say, God, do to me whatever you need to do. Whatever you need to do to break me, to bring honor and glory to your name. And then God begins to work. For when I'm weak, then am I strong. The breaking you're going through right now may end in the salvation of a family member, a neighbor, a co-worker, a child, a mother, a father, a brother, a sister. Just tell God, Lord, whatever you got to do, whatever you've got to do, I'm your willing servant. He broke it, He blessed it, He used it. That should be our surrender tonight. Lord, use me. If you got to break me, bless me, to use me, here I am. Are you willing? Are you willing to say, God, whatever it takes, Break me. Break me. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes just for a moment tonight, if you would. This is a tremendous truth, my friends. A tremendous truth. A tremendous truth. If we're going to be used, then God must break us. But it's a good breaking, and it's for His honor. It's for His glory. I wonder tonight how many say, Brother Munson, I'm willing to put my hand up as a testimony and ask you to pray for me, that I would be willing to do whatever it takes in order for God to break me, to use me. Could you raise your hand? Yes. God bless you. Amen. I see those hands, and God sees those hands. Whatever it takes, Lord, whatever road I need to go down, whatever road I need to go down for you to break me, use my life, and anoint my life. Anyone else? Just put it up and put them back down. Then how many of you say, Preacher, I believe I am going through some things right now that are very testing to my life. I'm going through some great tests, and I just covet prayer. I covet prayers. It's hard. Please remember me in prayer. Will you just lift your hand and put it back down? God sees. Just yes, yes. God bless you. Amen. I'm going through a time of testing, going through a time of trial. I feel kind of like Paul being beaten about the eyes. Please pray for me. Just lift it up, put it back down. Anyone else? I have to ask one more question. How many say, Brother Munson, if I died right now, I have no doubt in my mind I'm going to heaven. I remember the time, the place where I received Christ as my Savior, and I know I'm born again. I know I'm on my way to heaven. And here's my hand as a testimony to that. Could you lift up your hand? Say, I know I'm saved. I know I'm going to heaven. Amen. What a beautiful, beautiful sight that is. Amen. Listen, now, if you couldn't put up your hand, this is the best time. This is the best time. How many of you would be willing to say, who did not just raise your hand and say, Brother Munson, if I died, I'm not sure I'd go to heaven, but I'm interested. Please pray for me. Please pray for me. Could you lift up your hand and put it back down? I'm not sure I'm on my way to heaven, but I am interested. Yes, I see that hand. Is there anyone else? Put it up, put it back down. Only myself and God are watching. I'm not sure I'm going to heaven. Not positive. Please pray for me. Just put it up, put it down. Anyone else? Anyone else? Our Heavenly Father, we come to you and we pray for those, Lord, who are willing to go through whatever breaking process you want them to go through to bring honor and glory to your name. I pray for those, dear Father, who are going through testing right now and have asked for prayer. We pray for your grace. We pray for your mercy. We pray for the Holy Spirit to teach them and lead them through every step of the testing as you are breaking them even right now. Then, Father, for those who are not sure they're saved, dear God, may they walk this aisle. May they be serious about it and say, I want to be saved. And I'm coming forward to take my pastor's hand because I want to be saved. And Father, as we have this time of invitation, may your people leave their seats and find a place around this altar and be willing to yield completely to you and say, Lord, whatever it takes to break me, I come.